Hi, how are you? Can you hear me?
Hi,
Hello?
Luke.
Hello?
Hi.
So my video has been disabled by one of you all for some strange reason. I have no idea.
Priyanka.
How are you? Can you hear me?
I'm there.
Hi, Arjun.
How are you guys?
Very well. Luke,
Hi.
can you just test your audio 1 second, please?
Yeah, sure. Can you hear me?
Yeah, awesome.
Perfect. All
Priyanka, what about you? You're on mute, I see.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, awesome.
Okay, hi everyone.
Loud and clear.
Hi.
Awesome. It's 6 p.m. and I guess we're good to roll.
Yeah, superb. Okay, good evening, everyone. I'm Priyanka Sanghi, Chairperson, Young Fikki Ladies Organization, Ahmedabad Chapter. I welcome you all to today's unique webinar, which is curated by Mind Over Miles, a digital platform for wellness and health. A very warm welcome to our panelists, Arjun Kapoor, who needs no introduction, Luke Cutino, whose reputation precedes him, and our moderator for the day, Malika Singh. We really look forward to today's discussion. Malika is a highly accomplished leadership executive coach and has been a corporate HR for 8 years. She has worked in markets across the world where she leads Dialogue in the Dark. So let's begin the much-awaited session. Malika, over to you.
Thank you so much, Priyanka. Thank you so much for the very generous introduction. And thank you so much, Arjun, for taking time out and being a part of this awesome webinar with Mind Over Miles. Luke, thank you so much for your time and your expert advice that we're looking forward to. Arjun, we're really looking forward to some personal experiences, for you to share with our audiences. So really, thank you so much for all
Thank
our
you.
feedback.
Thank you for having me. This actually is just an excuse because I can't get an appointment with Luke. So this is a simpler way of me having a conversation with him. Actually, I just want everybody who's tuning in right now to know that I'm just using this as a very, very simple way of actually talking about
Awesome,
what.
awesome. Great, great.
So Luke's not getting paid for this one. I'm getting one for free, basically.
Sure, Arjun, works well with me.
Amazing.
Perfect.
Of course, to all our viewers, thank you so much. Mind Over Miles is a holistic platform, and this is our sixth conversation today. So thank you for being a part. Of course, like Priyanka said, Arjun needs no introduction with incredible movies like Gunde, Ishaqzade, Key & Ka, under his belt. Luke, of course, is a holistic lifestyle coach, and he will bring on board some subject matter advice. I'd actually like to start by saying, Luke's Arjun actually has been very forthcoming with his audiences and connected with his audience via social media. Incredibly, Arjun, thanks so much for that. And it's been a very you've been very forthcoming with your journey of fitness over the last 4 years that you've not I mean not ne necessarily over the last 4 years.
I mean, a lifetime, if you look at it.
It's been a 4 year journey of weight loss and fitness for you, which is incredible. Hats off and kudos to you for that incredible amount of perseverance. And of course, Luke's prevention and healing revolves around a four-pronged strategy, which is very much in sync with what Mind Over Miles, which is a holistic wellness platform, targets. It's balanced nutrition, adequate exercise, quality sleep, and of course, emotional detox. So without further delay, let's jump into our conversation for today, which is love for food, causes and consequences. What is, Arjun, this question's for you. What is the first thing that comes to your mind when it is the love for food?
Well, I think firstly, it all starts with upbringing. As a child, you are inculcated a habit in this country predominantly. Food is very, very relevant to a daily activity. You know, when you grow up in a joint family, when you grow up in a family when you come back from school, अरे कुछ खाया या नहीं खाया. When you go out to play, you come back, you're told कुछ खाया या नहीं खाया. You wake up in the morning, कुछ. It's a very, very systematic built up of for years. You're being told how relevant and important food is in your cultural activities, along with festivals, along with your outings. As a country, we love food. As a nation, we are obsessed with food. And children are no different. You know, the point is you're literally rewarded by if you get good marks, you get to go out. If you do well in studies, you're gifted. You have a birthday, you get to eat. It becomes an outing. You go to a restaurant in this city, in this country, sorry, not only Bombay, but I think across the country. I think it's embedded within us. And that's not a bad thing. It's just we don't know any better as kids. Or I think sometimes parents are not aware what the right balance is. So over the course of those years, there is a sense of gluttony that occurs unknowingly or knowingly from a child. And I'm not saying it leads to everybody being unhealthy, but right. You kind of get conditioned to eating certain kinds of food subconsciously. That includes, forget the division of carbs, protein, sugar, etc. It's just you get used to certain kinds of food being inbuilt in your system, which might not actually be congenial for you when you're growing up. It's also one thing when you grow up, then after that, you need certain kind of food to sustain your life. It's also the kind of food that maybe holds you back, you know, indigestion. India as a country predominantly doesn't realize we really eat heavy, spicy food. So food for me has always been an experience where I have loved it, but there are a lot of consequences that come with it health-wise, lifestyle-wise. And there are no answers because the internet will confuse you. People tell you out of their personal experience. So, jo aapko suit karta hai ya Luke ko suit karta hai, wo mujhe nahi karega.
Right.
So, where I think what happens is that there's just a confusion. There's an overlap of information. There's an overdose of information. And it just creates an anxiety and pressure about eating good food and feeling guilty about it. I feel food should not make you guilty. And that's something I realized a while back. Your health is correlated to what you eat. At the end of the day, you have to be aware, but that does not mean that you need to be paranoid. Now, it is extremes, right? Either you go into being somebody who just loves eating and doesn't care about fitness, or then what happens, you're so into fitness that you follow every fad and every diet, but don't kind of enjoy the journey. So I think that balance is always a struggle for each and every person. And I'm talking purely for myself also. I go through that struggle. Where I go into a phase that, you know, I need to cut off everything and just be very extreme. And then there is these 3-4 days, you know, I don't want to give a damn, especially in lockdown. I'm sure everybody's had ups and downs. Right. But in life, for me, that's been the big thing where food is attached to life in India.
So
but we can't be detached to enjoy the good part of it. You know, we always get bogged down by food.
So can we just talk about our relationship with food, the way you perceive food and your journey with food? I know your love for food from the interviews that I've seen, which you've shared with your viewers in the past. What has been your specific association and relationship with food, and how have you changed that mindset in the recent past?
So I've grown up in a Punjabi household where rajma chawal, chicken, you know, you need to have a full plate. Like there has to be a spread every day. You're enjoying food. You grow up loving food. And there is a whole conversation about raat ko kya khana hai, din mein kya khana hai. There is a build up to the day. Like you're planning your life around the food that you're going to eat. And I was 150 kilos. I became obese because of, maybe I'm diving right into saying the connect you have with food. I think food gave me a lot of solace when my parents split up at a time. Time like that, I started eating. And junk food had just come into the country at that point. You know, so there's a lot of solace in those kind of foods as a kid when you're growing up. So my relation with food was very healthy where the family was concerned because it used to be family driven. But then obviously one change in my life kind of drew me towards food for happiness. I don't know what's the right word. Maybe solace, distraction.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, it's an emotional connect that came in.
Right.
And then I'm sure Luke has many cases like this where it's food gives you temporary happiness.
Yeah.
It kind of makes you feel things are better. Till then, the food settles in you and you feel worse. You know, it's like it is an abuse that you start giving yourself. So I was 150 kgs. And it took me a long time to realize that that's not healthy. I mean, I was happy being overweight and I was happy eating. But then I obviously realized that I can't live a life like that. So growing up, food mattered. It still does. I mean, I will not deny. I still enjoy my food. But obviously, over a course of experience, transforming myself, handling thyroid, handling stuff like that, handling small things that do make a difference. I've come to maybe understanding food a little bit better and being able to maybe switch off and on with it. But yeah, it's a continuous, it's an everyday process.
Awesome. Thank you, Arjun. Thank you so much. No, I totally resonate with what you're saying, especially in this lockdown, be it busy schedule or not. I find myself, you know, opening the fridge a little bit more, finding that little bit of reassurance, comfort, you know, be it baking or be it daily food. I think the topic of conversation in a lot of households is what's getting cooked today. Luke, what is your advice on, what are your, you know, your expert advice on your relationship, the way you view food, the way you view nutrition? Can I have your viewpoint on that?
Sure. I think if we all see Arjun's journey right now, which he explained, he made it sound so simple. He didn't speak about fad diets, fad exercise programs. And that's exactly what nutrition and lifestyle is about. You know, most Indians have a poor relationship with food. They see chocolate, they've already labeled it as bad. They see a bowl of ice cream, even before they eat it, they've already labeled in their mind that I'm going to get fat when I eat this ice cream. So when you eat food with guilt, we produce stress. When you produce stress while you're eating, your digestive system really doesn't work. You're not really breaking down food. A lot of it is getting stored as fat. So it's a vicious cycle, like he rightly, you know, pointed out. So we eat to feel happy, and then all of a sudden we feel guilty about that. So then we're guilty, stress levels go up, we crave more carbs and sugar. So I think the relationship has to be simple. You know, nutrition is overhyped in our country. It's really about lifestyle. It's not so much about the food we eat, it's about how much we eat. Like, Indian food is great for us. You overdo it on the spices, you have problems. But the problem in India, people eat their dinners too late. They eat it at 10, 11, and they sleep right after that. So I think it's the lifestyle when it comes to the food. And of course, if you choose junk food, you know the path you're going down is destructive for you. But I think relationships, like real life relationships, if you don't have a good relationship with a person, it's going to result in, you know, guilt and stress and anger. It's the same thing with food. It creates the same emotion, which is guilt. And that creates problems with our health and our weight.
But Luke, there is so much uncertainty looming around us, especially with this lockdown and uncertainty of even it ending. At what point is it going to be normalcy again? Is this staying indoors our new normal? What, you know, with all these things, and life has thrown at a plethora of people different scenarios which they'd never envisioned for themselves, but are having to come face to face, be it loss of job, be it anxiety, be it stresses of family members suffering. And you know, a lot of people are during this lockdown finding comfort, and the equilibrium and that fine balance has been rocked a bit when it comes to association with food. You know, moms are baking a lot more with their kids than ever before. So there is a lot of refined carbs and sugar that's going in. A lot of, you know, rations aren't in many parts, not available as they were, you know, seamlessly else, otherwise. So there is a lot of emotional eating going on currently. Arjun, what are some of the battles that you've fought, and what really were the triggers that led you towards emotional? Would it be correct to term it as emotional eating for you, Arjun?
So I think firstly, what you were talking about is, you know, if you look at it only from the lockdown point of view, the conversation becomes a bit skewered, because this has been 3 months, but we've had, say, I've had 35 years of my life to figure an equation with food. If we just look at it in the lockdown, it's very difficult to have a conversation, because everybody will eventually turn around and say, it's okay to be unhealthy at a time like this. But you cannot look at it like that. I think the problem is we, as human beings, find reasons to not be logical about food. Absolutely. We find excuses. Yep. And the lockdown is an excuse. And I'm not saying this that you're weak or strong. I had it the first 2 weeks, 3 weeks. I was switched off and I said, you know, we'll figure it out. F it, it doesn't matter. Thodi na kaam pe jana. We all have that. The point is, and that's what's important, you have to go above and beyond that. That is the journey. The journey is not to go, it's a roller coaster, right? You will go down. But the point is, you have to get yourself up and get back on track. You can have a few days off. Everybody's going to have it. The best people in the world. I've seen people with great bodies who train hard, who work hard, who are fit. Everybody has moments. The point is, you have to find that equation with food long term. For me, like you're talking, the trigger, it started when I was a child. Then it continued being obese in college. Because I wanted to be a filmmaker, I never cared about being in front of the camera. Food, I never said no. Right. I could eat five meals a day or six meals a day without caring. The quantity, like Luke said, the timing, the quality of food, it didn't matter. I didn't care. As long as it was tasty, I was eating it. today I feel people are in a far better position. I'm not saying the internet has answers, but today you have a lot more people like Luke, for example.
Right.
You don't need to have an appointment with Luke to always understand his philosophy. You can actually read about what the man says. You can read about so many other nutritionists. There is so much more information available worldwide. The triggers you can get, but you can also find solutions to it. So I'll tell you one thing. Like he said, Luke said, chocolates, right? For a lot of people, that's a big craving.
Right.
I never knew I had a sweet tooth in my life till I lost weight. So when I was overweight, I didn't realize I had a sweet tooth, right? Because I was eating everything. And then I went into the zone of working out, training, working hard, learning how to... I could not even run. I started running, got very fit, ate clean, etc. And then I realized the one thing that really triggers me is this craving for meat. Because now I feel I'm thin, I can eat a lot of meat. And then my quantities went all over the place. But today, in a city like Mumbai, I'm sure there are a lot of people who must be wondering how easy it is. But in a city like Mumbai, you have a lot of options of healthier meat in that sense. You don't have to succumb to the first slab that is lying in front of you. You can actually make that extra effort. See, you're working your ass off to earn money, but then you won't make that extra effort to find cleaner, healthier options. Like cooking at home, cook it. You cook it, please cook it. But then just use better ingredients, better products. Right. Don't go into using the kind of material that is just freely available. Do a bit of research. And I've realized that. I've realized the benefit of that. It's small, but it goes a long way. If you just put in a little bit of effort. So today when I eat dark chocolate, I try and find a vegan dark chocolate. It is just a little more cleaner. It's not very difficult. Today, trust me, my sister finds stuff on the internet that I didn't know exists. You can find vegan mayo. Did anybody know that? I had no bloody idea.
You can find... No, to me, no, for sure.
And it might not taste the best, but when you have a craving of having a grilled chicken sandwich on a Sunday afternoon when it's raining, you don't need to dip your fingers into the heavy loaded mayonnaise all the time. If you want to just avoid that, you'll find cleaner options. Again, a lot of people say eating fat is good, but the problem is we tend to overeat that fat, right? If you are somebody who can't balance that, then find solutions for yourself.
Right.
If not,
alternatives and working your way around it. Right.
Yeah. If you can't control your appetite, like I can't eat less. I tend to eat a little bit extra. So then you have to find, I found lentil pasta for me is a very interesting option because it kind of gives me a bit of protein, a bit of carbs, and it doesn't have that kind of heavy carbs that don't digest well. So it kind of does. So I'm doing my due diligence. Now the payoff will be 6 months from today.
Right.
It might not be seen today, but I'll get used to that kind of food. So it's not rocket science, but you need to make an effort for your own body. You can't just expect results.
But that's a great takeaway, Arjun. That's a great takeaway to really look out there, do your R&D, look at alternatives that will work better for you, but still satiate your cravings. That's a really valuable takeaway. Thank you so much for that. Luke, I would like to ask you to, for our viewers who are tuned in today, to really just talk a little bit more about the emotional and mental consequences and how food plays such a big role on our mental health, as well as emotional, as well as physical. Can you just elaborate on that a little bit more, please?
So food definitely has an impact on every emotion because food basically drives serotonin and dopamine. That's our feel-good hormone and our pleasure hormone. So depending on the food that I eat, if I have fast food, it's got neuroexciters like salt and sugar. I'm going to feel good for about 5-10 minutes. And then when the crash happens, I'm going to feel terrible. And I'm going to get into that cycle of eating. So we have to understand. And I think I want to go back to Arjun's point because he explained that beautifully. This is not about lockdown. People have to understand emotions. Otherwise, everyone's constantly looking for better foods, better exercise programs. There was uncertainty. There were possible job losses, relationship issues, even before lockdown. And people just chose to eat more outside food. Today, moms are baking at home. At least they're using ingredients at home. They're not eating the crap that exists outside. We may have less products available, but we have the basics, which is what people should be eating. Yeah. Dal, chawal, rajma. Not all the fancy food that people eat 7 days in a week. So technically, it's an excuse. Everyone's sitting at home in lockdown saying that, oh, we're uncertain, let's eat. Somewhere we have to decide as individuals, when does it stop? Okay, like Arjun said, 4 or 5 bad days, but then get back on track. We can't use the lockdown excuse to continue our spiral. You know, so coming back to your question, food is everything. So we have tryptophan in food. That's a precursor. If I don't have enough of tryptophan, I cannot balance serotonin and dopamine. I just can't do it. So yes, food is linked to depression, anxiety, stress, but it's a vicious cycle. Now, if I'm stressed out, I'm not going to think about eating an apple. I'm going to start thinking about a carb or a sugar. So yeah. You see, we have to balance. We can't go around choosing foods and just eating that, expecting our moods to be better. It works together. I have to change the way I live emotionally. I have to change how much I focus on being into fear, negativity. It exists for everyone in this world. Everyone has both sadness, happiness, fear, anxiety, good days, bad days. But the difference between these people is how much of energy and focus they put into the negative feeling. So lockdown right now, everyone's dealt the same hand. Uncertainty, jobs, everyone. Everyone's dealt the same hand. But there's one population of people that is wallowing in all of this and spiraling, you know, deeper into it. And the others who have said, okay, it's there. Acceptance now. What's the best I can do? What can I do? What can I make the best out of the situation? And they move into action. So people will Google foods and eat these foods. But if they've not decided it in their mind that I want to move from negativity to action, the food's not going to work. So it's really a combination of a mindset change as well as the right foods to improve your mood.
So, like, I'm sorry, I'm cutting in, Luke.
Please, go ahead.
And this is just from personal experience. I don't have a single app to call food home. I've never had it on the phone because I know that might be a problem in the future. I've never had an app that allows food, like, you know, the delivery apps. So it cuts down a lot of my possibilities of staring at the options available to me. So I have to rely a lot more on the home cook stuff.
Yeah.
So that also makes a difference.
And that is such a good takeaway. As convenient as it is, you know, just
and I'm sure a lot of people live alone. A lot of people live alone and they have that issue. I'm saying I'm lucky that I have people who can figure it out for me. I'm sure people live alone. But I'm saying there are also a majority that don't live alone. So we do have the thing, you know, we get bored of the same food. The house food is not good enough. We have psychological triggers like that lead us to eating out, and it will happen. But the other thing, like Luke said, you have to be that person that doesn't wallow. Eventually, you can have a few bad days. But this lockdown is an amazing opportunity to actually find a new thought process around food. Yeah. And even, like for me, I've been to this place called Viva Maya. It is very interesting. It gives you a slight understanding about what your equation with food is personally for your body. I've done a bit of fad dieting in the past. We've gone extreme as actors. Sometimes you don't have the luxury of time. You push yourself to the limits. You train twice a day, thrice a day. I can understand. I have equipment at home. People don't. But the one major thing for me that always I feel works at the end of the day is that you need to want to be the change that you want to see. And for me, this time, I was detesting everything this time when lockdown started. You know, that April month was honestly tremendously poor for me. And I went through that phase of saying, screw the world. It's all over, Falana Dimkar. And then I don't believe I can do anything on Zoom. Like, I feel I can't do a class on a phone or an iPad. It's frustrating because I'm not physically in contact with the other person. I started doing yoga just for the heck of it. It was something that I'd never done in my life. And now I realize how much I value it and how much I've missed it. The fact that I started checking out the ingredients online and helping my sister order stuff that I would need to, you know, balance out and cooking at home.
Right.
I just became a little more involved in my own life rather than relying on circumstances. And that kind of made me feel better about, okay, I'm proactively trying to do something. It's like when I wanted to lose weight, everybody told me I'll never be able to do it. And then I left one particular thing that I felt, okay, this is the most favorite thing in the world that I can't live without. I couldn't live without rice. I just left it for a year. And I realized I have the willpower. I left it for 1 year. And that for me was a big thing, you know. So we don't know what we're capable of. 150 kilo kid who at the age of 18, 19 decided to do something, was able to do it then. You don't know what you're capable of till you don't put that mind to it. And that's what Luke, I think, is talking about. It's a mindset. We've all been through bad
stages. That mindset is what I wanted you to elaborate, which you've done so beautifully right now. Because, you know, it requires a great amount of resolve. It actually requires a great amount of mindset change in the way you view your food, your relationship with food.
And the way you view yourself. A lot of people look at themselves in the mirror without a t-shirt and say, I don't have the body of Hrithik Roshan, but that's not the end all. You also need to have a body and mind that will allow you to work in your 9-to-5 job and play with your kids at the end of it.
It's as brass
tacks as that. So why are you aiming for the thing that is not important to you, but it is perceived important by society? instead of actually just doing the bare minimum that will make you happy long term.
Brilliant.
Thank you so much, Arjun. That was a great amount of truth right there, taking away a lot of actionable points that you've really, shared with some of our viewers today. Luke, I'd just like to, talk to you about in this lockdown, of course, and you said lockdown or not, our relationship with food should be viewed irrespective of that. There are a lot of fad diets that are going around, which eliminate. And I find, I find elimination very, very restrictive because I generally try and find the balance of life, be it in sweet or fried or everything. But what is your take in a lot of diets that are currently, and fad diets that we've all tried and tested? Something comes about, you're excited, maybe it shapes your, or, works a different way with you. What is your viewpoint on that, Luke?
See, the only time most people would, it really depends. Like he rightly said, actors have, short time frames. Sometimes they have a movie coming up. They got to do a body transformation. So they got to do aggressive diets. I understand that. But for everyone else, people who chase fad diets, they don't have a relationship with food. They depend on the world to tell them what suits their body. They don't even know what a good meal can do for them. So fad diets eliminate a lot. And that's how we have most of our medical cases. A lot of our cases over and above cancer come because people have messed up their kidneys and liver with fad diets that eliminate key nutrients. Their goal is only weight loss. But with the weight loss, they lose, enzymes in their liver, the kidneys start, having issues. So I really think when you think of a diet, whenever you think of a good diet, it should be number one, sustainable. Two, it should make you happy. If your diet makes you psychologically deprived, you have a bigger problem on hand. And three, if your diet's only going to give you short-term results, you're going to be up and down yo-yoing between plans all the time. So I think people need to stop because, I always tell people, copy any celeb's diet. Will you end up looking like them? A lot of celebs, Hollywood and Bollywood, have posted their diets online and a lot of people have copied them. Have you got that body? No, everyone's individual and unique. And more than the diet, people need to change their mindset. Again, beautiful point, comparison. Most people today are depressed, unhappy, chasing diets because they're comparing themselves with everyone. They don't know how to be happy with what they have. And when you start comparing, the last thing that you look at are the things that truly make you happy because you're trying to copy the world and what people are eating and doing. So it comes down to a relationship with food and a relationship with yourself. I think people have to be grounded. People are connected outwards. They're not connected inwards anymore. So they've lost track of the game.
Luke, if I can ask you a question, since I'm getting this free appointment with you. I've born, brought up non-vegetarian. I've been a meat eater all my life. I'm allergic to seafood, so my meat intake has been on the higher side for years. Of late, I've never been a big fan of vegetarian food and definitely never understood what vegan, this whole philosophy is all about. Doing whatever due diligence and by trying it on myself, I do see vegetarian food has been more beneficial to my gut. It might not always be the tastiest option, but I've enjoyed that more in this last 5 months than I have in the past. And also, I want to know, what do you feel about being a vegan or being more vegetarian? Are these extremes or is it something that actually has long-term benefit value to switch to vegan ingredients as well as reducing the amount of non-vegetarian food in our diets?
So the way I see it, I look at my data. When I look at data of over 10,000 patients today, I have sick vegans, sick non-vegetarians, and sick vegetarians as well.
You basically have sick people.
Yeah, sick people. It doesn't matter. people fight. They fight about their diets. Be a vegan, but don't make it an extreme where you start fighting and people just defend it. Now, certain people, of course, you have a cardiovascular problem. You've just gone through a heart attack and bypass and you're non-veg. I would definitely want you to move plant-based so we can reduce inflammation. At the same time, if you were born and brought up on meat, you have to transition very slowly to vegetarian.
For me, I've done it kind of, just my dinners. I've started reducing the meat intake late at night, by like 8, 9 o'clock, the dinners that happen. I've gone more plant-based on that. And I've noticed a slight bit of difference in the digestion as well as the word you used, inflammation. I think a lot of people don't realize that non-veg does take a lot more time to digest. So your muscle soreness takes a lot of time to get okay because your body is using the energy to digest the food, not to repair your muscles.
Absolutely.
So I realized, but I just wanted to know what your opinion was about.
Oh, you're right. If it's suiting you, do it, but transition very slowly, which you're doing. See, we have to take an example. Meat eaters in Europe and America. What do? They have their steaks for dinner. They eat at 5 in the evening. Yeah. They sleep at 10 in the night. They don't eat after that. So you see, meat takes a long time to digest. If we have heavy non-vegetarian food at 10:30 and sleep at 11, we are bound to have problems with digestion. Then is it the problem with meat or the problem of the timing? So I think to each his own. I've had vegans who have gone vegan for 3 years and then it's not worked for them. They've changed to non-vegetarian. And I've had non-vegetarians change to vegan and it's worked beautifully for them. So I really think it's a choice and people should see, am I feeling good on this diet? The intention should be how I'm feeling. I should not be doing it because everyone's doing vegan. Let's jump on the bandwagon and start doing.
But that's what happens. That's what happens, right? We follow. Like, I mean, we all follow. We don't lead the way. Just by nature, for sure.
Right. Yeah, but I really, really value this input of really tuning into how your food makes you feel. So really tuning into the emotional side of it, that when you eat something, because we're also taken up and consumed by routines and chores. We sometimes don't even emotionally take time out to just see how you're feeling after having a certain amount of food or certain type of food. So, right. You know, now that we do have that little bit time on our hands, that's something, tuning into the emotional side of our relationship with food.
But I remember a time where I was working really hard. I was shooting for a film in England and I was working really hard. I was doing 19, 20 hour days because I had a double role in that film. And I was not eating bad. I was not eating wrong, but I was just eating at odd hours and odd times. And my stress levels were so high. Mm-hmm. We were staying far out from the city. So it was not like I was going out for dinners every night and stuff like that. I was living in a hotel with the crew, you know, so you're eating regular food at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. But when I came back, I had put on 8 kilos in 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. And I realized that my hormone levels had gone all over the place. Like Luke said, the stress was so much. It was beyond comprehension that my body actually, despite not eating, I was not eating great healthy food, but I was not eating extreme binge-worthy food. To put on 8 kilos is a lot of fat. That means, and it's not like I put on muscle because I was not training. I was just walking because I didn't have time to do anything else. So stress, and I was not even eating extra to handle the stress. Sometimes your body hormonally also can't handle it. That's what I also realized about myself, that my hormones fluctuate. And it's hereditary, right? It's genetics, because sometimes you come from a family history where you have certain things in your family where you have to be extra careful. And I think I realized after I did my tests, I realized that okay, my mom had thyroid, she had thalassemia, stuff like that. My father's side, etc. You realize, okay, so it's also, you need to be emotionally eating, but you need to be very aware of maybe certain histories that might trigger in me. You might have eaten the same food, it won't trigger in you. So along with emotional, it's also your hormones get imbalanced when you're stressed, man. That's the biggest thing. I realized that when I turned 30. Till you're 25, 26, nothing bothers you. Suddenly 31, 32, and you're like, boom, your body's kind of telling you, start paying attention, because by the time you're going to hit 40, it's going to be too late. It's basically your body giving you signs. And that's, I was like 32, 33. And I swear to you, that what happened about 3 years back has taken me 3 years to kind of counter program now, where I feel I'm able to handle the stress slightly better when it comes to the hormones and the food, where I'm able to find a better balance. It's taken me some time.
Wow. You know, thanks so much, Arjun. So many valuable inputs from both Luke and you. I'd actually like to just take some time out. You know, we've spoken about it, of course, physically. Maybe we haven't really elaborated, but that's common knowledge, the kind of consequences food can, and excessiveness of anything can have, other than mentally and emotionally, can have physically and on you. And Arjun, like you said, it's taken you nearly 4 years of a journey to, you know, shed off that weight. And it really is very cumbersome and you need a huge amount of perseverance to undertake, a weight loss program like that. So the physical aspects, of course, are understood. I'd actually like to touch upon, what are some of the micro steps? What are some of the actionable points? I really, really liked, Arjun, the fact that, you know, we feel so trigger happy with having these food apps, and they're so amazingly convenient that, you know, you have your kulfi within 15 minutes. And that is quite detrimental to your, of course, if you can balance it out, nothing like it. But, you know, the things like this are really quite a good go-to technique, especially if you are yo-yoing between, you know, excessive eating and binge eating ever so often. But Luke, I'd like to take, I'd like to get some inputs from you from with regards to what are some of the actionable points people can, and our viewers can and make use of and weave into their schedule, and not be incessantly opening the fridge, finding comfort in the food, overeating, finding weekends as like bingo, you know, the high point of the weekend is the food that we're cooking. So what are some of the, what are some of your go-to strategies for people to really find that equilibrium and relationship with food in case they've derailed?
So number one, we got to break it down and address the root cause. Where do cravings come from? Emotional, physical. If you're sleep deprived, you wake up in the morning with a hormonal imbalance. Your satiety hormone is at the lowest, and your hunger hormone, which is ghrelin, is at the highest. No matter what, you will be hungry and you will crave. So we got to first fix our sleep. Too much of sleep deprivation is going to cause that. Number two, okay, our gut. If we have poor gut health, we're constantly acidic, we're bloated, we're constipated, our bad bacteria is more than the good bacteria. The bad bacteria feeds on sugar and carbs. It's a living organism. So when it's hungry, you get a craving to feed it, carbs and sugar. It grows more and more, and the cravings increase more and more. So we have to look at gut health. Number three, if we're not eating well during the day, again, relates to his, to Arjun's experience in London. If we're not eating at regular times, we are getting hungry, because the body needs food, but we're pushing it off because of, you know, our shoots, our work priority, or whatever it is. So then the craving builds up, builds up, builds up, builds up into a binge. And then we will eat more and more. And the fourth step, again, is if we're not psychologically happy with what we're eating, the mind is constantly going to search for pleasure. Every human being is wired to seek pleasure and avoid pain. So when I eat a good meal, once the pleasure point connects, okay, and the brain realizes, because our five senses are involved, we look for taste, we look for food appeal, we also look for pleasure. So if we don't get pleasure, the body's going to keep craving until it hits the pleasure point. That's the complete cycle. It's the same thing with sex. If you have sex and you don't get pleasure, you're still hungry. You still want to get it until you get pleasure. It's a cycle that completes, because pleasure is uniform with food, sex, happiness, and everything else. So we have to understand, you know, that depth of emotion in the human body. When humans are not happy, we go searching for more happiness. The brain will go searching for that pleasure signal if we're not eating the right food. So people who are eating carrot sticks and cucumber sticks all day trying to lose weight, absolutely it's going to build up into a craving. So these are the points that we should take care of, and exercise. If you're sedentary, you will feel more hungry. You will feel more hungry if you're sedentary.
So what I hear you saying, and what you're alluding to, is really tap into your emotional needs to, and then, and that's the function of what you put into your system stems from there.
Would that, and let me add one more point. So food lobbies know this, and that's why it's the target. Yeah, you're feeling low, here's a cupcake. You're feeling sad, here's a donut.
They know it.
It's a perfect business.
Yeah, sure. Arjun, what are your go-to strategies, lockdown or not? What are your go-to strategies for finding that very fine equilibrium and relationship with food that you've so fantastically established for yourself? We have just about another 10 minutes before we jump into post your question. I'd love to take a few I'd love to take a few questions from the audiences. So what is your go-to tips?
I mean, it's very difficult for me to say if I have go-to tips. You know, I've always been somebody who's kind of relied on not putting pressure on myself by being on extreme diets. But the thing is, I work in a profession where you have to be slightly more disciplined over a course of shorter periods to see results. But like Luke was saying, eventually you have to make a lifestyle out of it. So when I remember when I was losing my 50 kgs, I can talk about back then when it was, I had more time and I was not aiming just to be an actor. It was just to lose weight. The first principle I followed was that don't listen to everybody. Just do your thing. Keep your head down. Believe in what you are doing. Follow it. Customize it for yourself. Don't try and go to a gym and run faster because another person is doing it. Don't try and lift extra weight because don't try and eat less because you want to prove to somebody that you're on a diet and then go home and binge. Don't do shit like that because it's not going to help. Don't do this for anybody else. You have to always keep yourself at the forefront. It will take time. Please realize that's the one thing about changing your relationship with food and your body, transforming or seeing results. It does take time. Enjoy the journey. You'll have bad days. Live with it. Get back up. Get on the horse. Ride again.
Yeah.
That's the most important tip at the end of the day. It took me 4 years to lose 50 kgs and I didn't know how to run. Malika, I did a film called Gunde about 5 years back. I had to learn how to run for that. I never knew how to run. I became an actor without even knowing how to run.
Arjun, what an honest confession.
So, yeah, but it was one of those situations where I learned how to do it after I learned how to walk for an hour without feeling breathless because I was that overweight. So, you need to do it for yourself and you need to believe in yourself. Everybody will tell you this works, that works. Eventually, it's a trial and error. You will go through bad days, good days. You discover it for yourself. And most importantly, something which I felt that pressure, I've dealt with it, now I've stopped believing in it, is don't go on that weighing scale every morning expecting a result. Yeah, you have a glass of water, your result is different. Mm-hmm. You will, and I'm not saying don't ever go on the weighing scale, but so if I tell you how much I weighed when I did Ishak Zade, people will be shocked. I was 94 and a half kgs the day I shot my first shot, but I didn't look that because I was not training. I was not weight training. I was doing functional training. I was eating maybe more than I'm eating today because at that point, my metabolism of 5 years of building up to losing weight was at an all-time high. I ate jalebis before I gave that body shot in Ishak Zade where I lifted my t-shirt because they told me after I ate the jalebi that I have to show my abs. but today, I can't do that. So, you cannot live in your 26 body. You have to adapt to it. But at the same time, I did that then because like Luke said, I didn't have the stress hormone. I was not building up towards body dikhani, ye karna hai. So I didn't go on the weighing scale every day to check, am I 88 today? Am I 87 today? Am I 83 today? I just lived at that point. Sometimes it's an amazing feeling to just be and just go through the journey of making it part of your lifestyle. It just becomes.
I love it.
So I guess that, I can't say it's tips. I'm just what I always try and tell anybody who takes my advice or listens to me is just you got to make it part of who you are rather than expecting overnight results. You'll see it in 6 months, in a year. You'll see it at some point. If you make it a habit and a lifestyle, you will see. It might not be for others to see. You will see it. And I think that's most important. We all do things for exterior validation.
Yeah.
You have to also do things.
Fitness is not a destination, as they say. It's the journey. It's the lifestyle. But I have loved your candid, inputs, experiences with our viewers today. Luke, I have really cherished your subject matter expert and your expert advice on this panel. I particularly I love topics like this because I love nutrition. I'm forever, striving for that fine balance in life. And I've really, really enjoyed this conversation with both of you on board. We've got a few minutes left, but I'd like to take some questions in from the audience. Could you provide us some examples of exposures and safety behaviors you use to treat eating disorders? This has come from Ayushi, from Ahmedabad.
I think Luke should answer that. I'm not treating anybody's food.
Yeah, can you just repeat the exposure part? I didn't understand that.
Right.
Say it again.
Could you provide us some examples of exposures and safety behaviors you use to treat eating disorders? So, we are a little pressed for time. So your key inputs for Ayushi.
I think it's awareness. I still didn't get the question, but I think I relate to it. So it's awareness. Be conscious about what you're eating. Just don't eat mindlessly. People want to enjoy the weekend. Go ahead, enjoy it. But be aware of what you're eating and how much you're eating. Why are you doing it? Are you binge eating and binge drinking just because you want to fit into the group that everyone around you, that everyone's doing? So I think conscious living. I think Arjun, he didn't have tips, but I believe people learn through stories and not tips. That's what he did. He's consciously made decision and lifestyle changes. So I think conscious living, that's it. Once in a way, just let go. Don't be conscious, but then get back on track and live with awareness. You should know what you're putting in your body. You should know when you finish that lazy phase and it's time for me to get back. Mm. So it comes down to personal responsibility, discipline, and consistency.
Arjun, I have. Thank you so much, Luke. I hope your question's been answered. Arjun, I have a question coming in from you from Niharika. Arjun, how were you able to control over your indulging in desires on certain foods? Also, is all junk food bad fat, or can we label as good fat?
I mean, I'm not an expert. You have Luke here, so he should answer the junk food part. I think it's only fair. I'm assuming there's a reason it's called junk because that word in itself has an answer in there if you realize it. I cannot pretend and say I don't enjoy it, but I'm aware while I'm enjoying it. Like Luke said, you need to be aware of what you're putting in into your system. So let's put it this way. The same junk that is available, say outside, when you crave fried chicken, you can have it at home, maybe as grilled chicken. Now, but that's something that you need to figure out. If you're going to have the fried chicken, then now you're having fried chicken. Don't pretend that I'm on a diet. Then enjoy it.
Just enjoy it.
Healthy alternatives. This is coming back to a point of healthy alternatives and looking at
options. Thing is, see, don't look at junk food to feel healthy. That's a daft way of perceiving life, right? You're doing something wrong and saying, what is right about this wrong? It's wrong. Now, enjoy it. It's okay. You know what it is. So don't lie to yourself that there is something good about eating junk food. There isn't. But there's nothing wrong with you knowing that you're doing something that you're doing for yourself in that moment. You cannot rationalize junk food by finding what is good in this. Yeah. It's made in 3 minutes with a frying pan behind while you're standing there and paying money at the counter.
How can it be healthy for you?
Very angry,
Right.
It's not about indulge, enjoy, Malika. I'm saying people should not look for finding a silver lining in knowing. Yeah. It's like you're in your mind suddenly saying, aaj main ye burger kha raha hu na, isme achhi baat hai na, there's lettuce, there's chicken and there's carbs. So I'm having a balanced meat. That's bullshit. Don't kid yourself.
I liked your point that don't kid yourself. That it is,
so don't
is
do
bad
it.
And be okay with eating it. So enjoy it in that moment.
Yeah, and then clip it off your life and then tomorrow morning, find something to make it clean again in that sense.
Absolutely.
Agreed. Easier said than done, but that's the agenda. And the second part of the question, I forgot. Sorry, I've given such a thesis.
It's about fat. It's about fat, but you answered it. If it's junk, it's junk. What do you want to know? People want validation on, will the fat be good in it at least so I can have it? So I think people look for validation and even the bad things. If it's bad, it's bad. You know it. Do it. Get back on track or don't do it at all. It's as simple as that.
And stuff like good fat is, I mean, in the sense, I think in India, ghee is considered good fat, I guess.
Yeah.
So if you're, if today you don't want to use refined oil, I guess ghee would be a good fat at home, stuff like that to use, which I
would
be able to answer better. That's substituting within your house. But I don't think outside people are serving you good fat and bad fat. They're just
No way. Absolutely. Right. No way.
Agree. Yeah. On that question, I think we have a few more. There is, Luke, a really pertinent question, but I know we're totally strapped for time to take it forward, which is gut health and mental wellbeing.
But please ask him that.
Go ahead.
I would like to know the answer. Yeah, exactly. Like, how would I know on a regular basis if I can't pick up the phone on Luke Coutinho that my gut needs some work or I need to change my lifestyle?
So it's really simple.
What is your input to gut health?
It's really simple. If you get bloated all the time. Now, sometimes, you indulge in a heavy meal. You may get bloated for about an hour and then your stomach comes back to the normal size. But if you're constantly bloated, if you have constant gas, everyone has flatulence. But if yours is persistent, there's an issue. If you get acidic, heartburn all the time. One day you're constipated, the next day you pass like 3 motions in a day. Those are signs of your gut telling you. And again, cravings. If you have these insane cravings of carbs where willpower can't work and you just need to eat it. So, sometimes you'll open a packet of biscuits and you finish the entire packet of biscuits because that's how deep the craving is. That's a sign that the bad bacteria in your gut is.
So how do you tackle that short term? Like at this point, I'm sure people are in lockdown and they're all dealing with exactly what you're talking about. They're thinking, okay, from Sunday, we'll finish binge eating. Monday, we'll start. But how do you break that cycle? How do you do that? How do you start improving the gut health, basically, slow and steady?
So number one, start eating meals on time. So your body, it follows a clock. It starts digesting food at the right time. I can't have lunch at 1 today and then at 2:30 tomorrow. It confuses the body cycle. 2, your prebiotics and your probiotics. I'm not talking about supplements. I'm talking about your natural food. So in India, a tradition, whether you're vegetarian or non-vegetarian, maybe not for the Jains, we would start our food with chili and onion, raw onion. That's a prebiotic. That sets the way your body's going to break down food. Your gut's going to work. Your probiotic is either your yogurt. If you're vegan and you don't do it, it's your pickles. But well-made pickles. You get a lot of junk in the market and you get pickles which are made the right way, or your fermented vegetables and fruits. So if you're having a balanced diet, we already have prebiotics built in fruits, in, you know, certain vegetables, and we have probiotics built in our food as well. Of course, you're going through antibiotics. You need to know if you're self-medicating, popping painkillers and antibiotics all the time, you're destroying your gut. Then you got to take probiotics. Stay hydrated. If you're dehydrated, you have bad gut health. Chew your food. I think this has solved most of the people's problems. If you're eating too fast, you're producing more acid. Yeah, just chew your food. The enzymes that break down food work more efficiently. So I think
the enzymes are literally in your. I mean, we don't realize that the tongue has more digestive enzymes than people realize. People think
it starts under in the saliva. It starts in the saliva. So if we chew, we produce saliva, which breaks down. We have amylase and lipase that breaks down carbs and fat. So the digestion of carbs and fat actually starts in the mouth. So if we're swallowing our food and not chewing it, then we got to make the pancreatic enzymes work harder, which, you know, we shouldn't be burdening out those organs. So it really comes down to that. And don't do fat diets. People just starve themselves. They leave long gaps in between their meals and stuff. There's a big difference between fasting and starving.
I'm asking questions in the middle of questions because I'm taking advantage. But I've realized India is very lactose heavy also. I feel that also has an issue with gut health. We overtly use lactose. And I've noticed when I've reduced the lactose intake, my gut health is far superior when I'm not. Like, we are tea and coffee drinkers with like this much of milk inside, you know.
Mm-hmm. That's too much.
So I feel that's a big sign in our country where you can reduce the amount of lactose going into your system. I think that's a big... Also, Indian food has a lot of lactose. You know, you put a lot
lactose and even gluten. Because see, if you go back years, the quality of milk today is very different. And most people have bad gut health. They don't have the enzyme to break down milk. And that's why they bloat up. And a lot of people don't have the enzyme to break down gluten because of the quality of wheat. Today, it's highly processed. So again, if you're eating wheat, if you're eating gluten and dairy, when you're intolerant to this, you're going to have a lot of gut issues. Sometimes
I just reduced lactose and I noticed a huge difference. I figured out that is something. And of course, you find better options sometimes to wheat in across the world where you can find ragi, bajra, jawar, served in many different ways. So I guess that's something which I also felt reduces the heaviness in the Indian food department.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But you know, Luke, I find the Swiss, they eat incredible. The Dutch, they eat huge amounts of cheese, you know, and
they have the enzymes, I think, to digest.
And remember, that's lactase. The problem with milk is it's lactose. Lactase is way more easily digestible. And two, the quality of milk. You cannot compare the quality of milk in Switzerland with the quality of milk. We have great milk if we're doing A2, the Indian cow. But most of the cows are Jersey cows. They're injected with hormones and estrogen. And that creates more oxidative stress on the gut, you know, on the gut lining. So we have to also look at quality and genetics. I mean, Indians before could tolerate a lot of lactose until they started pumping the cows. And then that's when all the problems. So it's really a fine mix. You know, and if it suits you, do it. If you're overdoing it, you bloat, and you know that you should stop that.
Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. I have really enjoyed this, even though we've run a couple of minutes over time. This has been incredible. Arjun, thank you so much. Priyanka, hey, welcome on board again.
Hi. It was such an insightful session. Thank you, Arjun. Thank you, Luke. Thank you, Malika, for your time and sharing your knowledge and experiences with all of us with so much of honesty. It was a most amazing Saturday evening. On behalf of Biflow Committee, I thank all of you, and from directors of Orient, Sunny Sara and Ritik Vaseem, want to thank you for your precious time. Have a great weekend. Thank you.
Most welcome. Thank you so much.
Bye, everyone. Thank you. See you guys. Bye, bye, bye.
Yes, mind of the minds for conducting such fabulous sessions. Thank you once again, Luke, Arjun and Priyanka.